The death of a beloved card game is never easy to accept. Greetings, owners of fine luxury cardboard rectangles. We are here to talk about the great force of will collapse. Now, there are a lot of people who worry about the collapse of Magic the Gathering, the game just kind of going away. They're going to go digital only. The game's done for, all this kind of thing, without realizing how strong and stable Magic the Gathering is. In all honesty, to see how a game collapses and crumbles and disappears, you need a good case study. And they're actually kind of hard to come by. A lot of card games are in and out so fast that you can't really use them effectively to like look at a nice lifespan of a game and go, okay, here's what happened with it, here's why it failed. A lot of the time, games just fail because they can't even establish market share, right? You've got Magic the Gathering, Yu-Gi-Oh! And Pokemon that lord over the top of card games. But we're going to talk today about the Force of Will card game because I think it's a fantastic case study in how a game can just fall apart and the way that it crumbles and collapses, because I've been watching the signs for a while now, and after being down there with the Force of Will guys today, it kind of revitalized my interest in the subject because I genuinely feel bad for them, and I've realized even the way I'm talking now, I don't consider myself really a Force of Will guy anymore. Apparently, it's like I am interested in the cards to a degree, but I don't have much interest in going forwards and picking up a bunch of it. Like, the passion's somewhat gone, and I feel like that's happened for a lot of people. But the thing about the Force of Will card game is it's been around for years, many years, which makes it an excellent example to talk about. And in terms of quality, like, this is a booster box from the game. They are very, very rugged. Like, these are stronger than the Magic bundles or anything like that. And it's just a booster box with this nice stylish design. As far as I'm concerned, Force of Will, hands down, these old school booster boxes, nicest booster boxes I've ever seen for any game. Maybe there's something more premium out there, but those were banger. The quality of the cards, immaculate. I had only ever seen one misprinted Force of Will card in the entire time that I messed around with these cards. And the cards are really rugged. They come out nice and flat, well printed, can take a lot of use before they start to show signs of wear. There's a new game that I'm getting into now. The cards get damaged pretty easily. I'm actually going to discuss that game over on my other channel. I think the video will probably come out tonight. But either way, I don't want to get sidetracked too much. Force of Will card quality was amazing. They have beautiful, like, popping art in the game. Just eye-catching. And also, they're unfettered by a lot of concerns about a lot of things that, like, are going on in the world and whatever. They're just like, you know what? Let's just have fun. Let's just play around with, like, goofy anime-esque characters and stuff like that. It's an enjoyable concept from a visual perspective. From a gameplay perspective, they basically straight jacked Magic's system. It's like, it's pretty much like we took Magic and changed it just enough that we can't get sued. And they separated out your main deck and your land deck, and it's really, really close to Magic the Gathering. And you know how fun Magic the Gathering is, obviously, right? So Force of Will is genuinely a fun game with, it did have some balancing issues, but I mean, that comes along with virtually any game, and there's certain problems you can accept with a game that aren't that big a deal. And I got involved with Force of Will accidentally. Basically, I bought a collection of Magic cards off of somebody, and they did the old stufferoonie swindle. If you don't know what that is, that's my term for when you buy, like, let's say you buy 5 boxes of something from somebody, big long row boxes or whatever, and then you open them up and 1 or 2 rows of one of these boxes, so thousands of cards, just happen to be, oh, oops, there's Lord of the Rings, oops, here's Shadow Fist cards. It's like, every once in a while you can believe, oh, you know what, maybe this is accidental, but there's some people, they just go, I'm just gonna dump this on you. So I got a bunch of Force of Will dumped on me, including all these these weird little white slips of paper. I had no idea what they were. It turned out they were like popsicle stick points, right? You know, the old days you could like eat popsicles and the stick would be worth a point, and then you could mail them in for like a frisbee. I'm so old. Anyways, Force of Will had the system where you build up these points, And then you'd get awesome cards, right? And like the game, when I actually got into it, was like, oh, this is fun. So I started collecting up a bunch of these points by basically just trading stacks of them off of people. And the way the game works is they would use these points to rank you. And they didn't have like a DCI tournament system like Magic does. So the only ranking they used at all was how many pack points you had redeemed. And so because of all the pack points and everything I redeemed, I was ranked 52nd in the world in Force of Will before I had actually really played a game. I owned some cards and looked at them, but I had never played. And I'm like, I'm number 52 in the world. So it was fun at first. I was having a good time with it. There's a little bit of broken nonsense, but whatever. It's a fun little side game kind of thing. It was never going to be my main squeeze. But at this point, the game is just completely suffering. Like, this is years from... I started a few years ago when everything seemed normal, right? And there was a pretty vibrant community for Force of Will at my local game store, right? Now, it appears that what's going on at my local game store is pretty much happening across, like, the world with Force of Will. There's a diminished interest in it due to mismanagement of the game, but... when I started out, things were banging. There was a group of people who would come and play. There was probably like 8 or 10 people playing Force of Will. Sometimes there was actually more people playing Force of Will than Magic. That wasn't frequent, but it did happen. And these guys were like tight-knit groups that would travel up to bigger events and things like that. Oh, there's a big tournament going in Toronto. They would go like long distance to play the game. We're talking like hardcore dedicated players. All like everybody seemed super into it, right? They're all hardcore. They're all having a great time. And like the game had an okay secondary market. It wasn't like an amazing secondary market, but you could still go into stores and they would be carrying the singles. They'd have binders of the singles. They would take singles off of you. So there was that flow back and forth where it's like you can trade in cards to get more. You can get cards from the store. So you don't have supply issues in either way. Like you have the ability to trade in to keep your collection flowing. And you also have the ability to buy to make sure you can get the cards that you want. The stores keep opening packs. All that stuff keeps flowing, right? Because if any of that starts to break down, then it spreads across and makes the game seem like it's failing. The truth of the matter is, one of the biggest stumbling blocks for games that are like coming out is they're expected to meet the standards of pre-existing games in terms of like secondary market. If you can't get your game established with a big secondary market, then you're going to have a huge problem getting people involved with the game. For example, the prices on stuff right now for Force of Will is to the point where, like, I want this super amazing, incredibly awesome rare. Okay, that'll be 30 cents. And we're talking like a really good card that's useful. You can get it for like 35 cents. And something that's so insanely powerful that it has to be banned, that'll top out at like $1. Right? Look at stuff like Omnath, where he gets a ban. He's still kicking around for $30, $35. Like, the expectation to have a secondary market is pretty heavy. And if it can't be sustained, then that diminishes the value of a game overall. If I can spend $50 on one of these three card games and be reasonably assured that I can get some of that money back, or I'm going to put $50 into your game and I'm not going to get any of that back, then your game needs to be that much more fun or better. It has to bring something else of added value to convince me to spend that money. Because unfortunately, the truth is, card games are very much rooted now in the concept of financial secondary markets and investing everything. It's a part of all of the major card games, and it's woven in there to the point where even the companies that make the products take that into account. So it's essentially at this point baked into Magic. Magic is no longer just a game. These other card games all function like that. And so you have to be able to establish yourself on that level. And that's one of the things that makes it the hardest, where you've got to convince enough people to get into the game, and then you've got to keep that momentum going and go for years and years and years. And Force of Will managed that. They managed to have enough of a secondary market, keep things going, keep making new sets, and things were going along reasonably well. And then they started to make different tweaks here or there where they got like a little bit greedier with the options that they were doing. You know, you have the specific cards that people are chasing in the Force of Will, and they would make it so you could only get like two of them in a whole box and whatever. And then they started trying to reduce the amount of those that you could get and create special ones that you had to buy multiple boxes to get. So it started to create these additional sideways, bigger hoops you had to jump through, more money you had to spend. We're going to do a buy a box promo. We're actually going to do two buy a box promos, but here's the thing. you only get this other buy a box promo if you buy two boxes. So they started like ramping up the greed in that way, and people started to take a little bit of a step back, and then things got murky. I'm not 100% sure, because in all honesty, one of the symptoms is of games like kind of fading away is people coming in and out of the game. And there were phases where I was way more into Force of Will and I was like, I want a bunch of new stuff. And then phases where it just sat on the shelf and I was like, oh, I'm playing this other game right now. I'm not even paying attention to Force of Will, right? So basically we progress along this path where it looks like they're getting cheaper with the artwork. Like normally if you have a flip version of a card, it's the same character on the other side, but it has like different artwork and a different flow to it. But then they just, you flip the card over and it's got the same artwork with some minor tweaks. You could tell they were cutting costs here and there. So that impacts the quality of the game as well, right? And then you get to the point where I got a box of Ghost in the Shell Force Will. I really didn't know how bad things had gotten until I got that box. And that's what caused me to dig deeper and ask the Force of Will guys about things, because the Ghost in the Shell box of Force of Will was eye-openingly awful. The glorious, beautiful, vibrant artwork that I knew Force of Will for was replaced by ugly screenshots from a show that I was startled to find out was actually made in 2020. There's a Ghost in the Shell show on Netflix that I have not watched, but there are screenshots used from that show for the card art, and it looks abysmal. Honestly, it looks worse to me than screenshots of like Final Fantasy Spirits Within would from however many years ago, but that same kind of concept, right? There was one card that's literally it's supposed to be Black Hawk Helicopter. And there are, all it is, you know how the helicopters have lights under them, whatever, beams, like beams of light? It's just like a screenshot of some lights. It looks just, I couldn't even figure out what it was at first. I looked at the art and I'm like, what is this? And then I looked at the name and I'm like, this is the bottom of the helicopter with lights? What? This is so, like, that was just garbage. The whole tie-in set seemed like garbage. Although I've heard the power level of the cards was half decent. But for me, part of the enjoyment is the aesthetics of it. And getting, like, these ugly cards was pretty frustrating for me. But now, after getting back in touch with the Force of Will guys, I realize how bad things have gotten. Because the group has shrunk down to a group of 3 or 4 players at most right now. Like, nobody else is coming out to play Force of Will because they've all abandoned the game. So these squads of people that would travel cross country to play this game now want absolutely nothing to do with it. The only ones who are left are the diehards. I took the boxes. I was recently sent a bunch of cool Force of Will cards by James P. Thanks for that, buddy, if you're watching. He sent me up those cards, and I took them down there to show the Force of Will guys, have a chat, see if they wanted any of this stuff. So they're going through it, and the whole time that I was there, the 3 guys who were there for most of the time were just chattering about all these different deck combos. There was all this stuff they wanted to tell me. The same kind of, like, going on and on and on, like I do about things that I love, like Magic and everything else. They're doing it about Force of Will. You can feel the passion that they have. They love this game. These are the diehards, the ones who are left, and yet at this point, they've decided, they're looking at all this old stuff, like, oh, I need this for my decks, this is great, I want this stuff, because I'm not getting any of the new stuff going forwards. I'm not buying any more of their product. Apparently they've gone insane power creep with the upcoming stuff. It's so powerful that they've all decided to nope out. And these were the ones who were still hanging on. I spoke with the guy who owns the LGS to talk about the situation with Force of Will, and he's basically outlined that it's fairly dire in terms of the fate for the game, not for the store. Force of Will is so insignificant in terms of the products that he carries, it's getting to the point where if the regulars, those 3 diehards, are like, I don't want anymore, he's probably just going to stop ordering it altogether. He doesn't carry boxes of it sitting out on the shelf. Like, the game is a, like, to-order-only game already, and the only people who would order it are all going, nah, man, you know what? They're literally now making their own cards. They've gotten to the point where they're just designing their own cards and only playing with old-school cards. They've made their own cutoff. And that kind of format exists in Magic as well, but I feel like the people who play that format are doing it more for the nostalgia and controlled environment of yesteryear, where it's like, I remember when I started Magic at the beginning, it was a different time. And it was. I played then. And a lot of the cards that existed then, some of them are really powerful. Some of them are completely outclassed. So I don't feel like this is the same situation with Magic, where they have the 93-94 format. Magic's perfectly healthy. But Force of Will is, it's pretty much feels like it's doomed at this point, right? Like, this is what it looks like to watch a card game flop and founder to the point where it's like you've lost consumer confidence. You've made too many mistakes without enough of a presence to be able to weather those mistakes. Magic the Gathering can make a crazy amount of mistakes because they have a crazy amount of customers. They have a lot of money on the table. Magic the Gathering isn't some little side game, right? And that's the hurdle that every game has to overcome, but not just overcome, maintain against entirely. Force of Will was never able to make itself like prominent on the level of the big three. It made itself prominent enough for people like me to get involved with it, right? Which I still like Force of Will. Don't get me wrong. I'm not like anti-Force of Will, but I'm also super casual about Force of Will. And I'd like to have more Force of Will as they make stuff, but I don't also, I'm not going to like cry if the company just kind of collapses. If they're mismanaging the game to the point where it looks like their entire player base has left or is unhappy. You know, it's just, it's interesting to see from a perspective of a game that has actually been around long enough to really feel like you had a chance. Like, if it had been managed properly up until the end, maybe it would still have longevity, and who knows? Maybe I'm wrong, and maybe I'm correlating what's going on with, like, my local playgroup over the world, but it looks like in the, like, Facebook groups and stuff like that, there's less activity, except in the marketplace where there's more and more people trying to dump their stuff, and TCG player prices on this stuff is super low. Like the card that I was talking about before with the rare, it's like, this one's banned, it's so good, it's a dollar. That's like TCG high. Actually, speaking of TCG player, if you didn't know, I have a TCG player link in the description. So if you buy stuff online using TCG player, whatever, use my link, I get the hookup, just so you know. Don't mention it very often. Anyways, Force of Will is an interesting case study in a game that had fantastic potential, right? You had excellent card quality. It took everything awesome that Magic had to offer and built upon it, making it a more smooth gameplay. Like, honestly, Force of Will gameplay is really solid. And the cards are beautiful. They paid for good artwork. But they've reached the point now where the areas they've chosen to get cheap and whatever is just too much for the customer base to bear. And they're in dire need of making some changes if they want to survive, right? As far as I'm concerned right now, Force of Will is on a downward trajectory and has very little chance of pulling back up out of it. I don't know. Either way, you know what? To end on a nice note, it was very gratifying today to be hanging out at the LGS. People were playing Magic. We had the Commander Legends drafts going on, multiple of those drafts, because this store has a huge amount of play space, right? So everybody can be spaced out nicely. There's a bunch of the Force of Will guys. Like, not a bunch, but you know what I mean. Like, a little group, three or four, you know, whatever. Playing Force of Will, having fun. There's other people wargaming and stuff, people coming in, picking up games. It's just a nice experience overall. And in case everybody's wondering, everyone had their masks, because that's how we roll. So, thanks for coming by, everybody. Let me know your thoughts. I just thought it'd be interesting to talk about this as, you know, kind of a side thing. Allay your fears. Magic the Gathering, you got nothing to worry about. It's not going nowhere. All right, so as I said, I'm going to be doing a review of another card game on my other channel. If that review is done, you'll find a link to it up on the screen. And if not, well then, I just look like a crazy person. All right, so goodbye, my friends. I'll see y'all later.